Hello, I'm Ralph Howe, pastor of First United Methodist Church, and I welcome you to this unusual form of worship, a video in which there will be prayers and scripture and preaching and music provided by our musicians and collected from our archives. I wish you safety and good health. May you have compassion on those around you and share the love that you can while maintaining your social distance. Let us join in worship. Amen. Let us hear the gospel of the Lord taken from the gospel according to St. John in the 9th chapter. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is still day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, Then how were your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud and spread it on my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. And I went and washed and received my sight. And they said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to question him about how he received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes, and then I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner perform such signs? And they were divided. So they said again to the man, what do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened. He said, he is a prophet. And the leaders did not believe that he had been blind and that he had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, is this your son who you say was born blind? And then how does he now see? His parents answered, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that he now sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the leaders, for the leaders had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age. Ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, I do not know whether he is a sinner or not. One thing I do know, though, is that I was blind and now I see. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And he answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples? They reviled him, saying, you are his disciple? But we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened his eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And they answered him, you were born entirely in sins, and you are trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir? Tell me that I may believe in him. And Jesus said to him, you have seen him. The one speaking with you is he. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, surely we are not blind, are we? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say we see, your sin remains. As we find ourselves in the midst of a health crisis of global proportions, we discover anxiety and fear creeping into our consciousness and lingering about in the recesses of our minds. Human nature being what it is, we tend to look for who to blame for our troubles. We even start to blame the victims of health troubles. Back in the early years of the HIV epidemic, many were happy to blame those who were sick and dying. There was the added handy bigotry of blaming persons who were gay for that illness. Again, in this time, we find people looking for enemies, especially foreigners. This is so very wrong. But it is not new. 2,000 years ago, those in positions of power had a solution to illness: blaming. They claimed that people were ill because they or their parents were sinners, violators of God's law. Sadly, we still hear this ignorant hate-mongering among so-called Christians today. But Jesus rejected this in unqualified terms. We also have folks who claim that to be Christian, telling us to come for their faith healing and not to take practical means of minimizing the spread of COVID-19. They assume that faith will replace medicine as a general rule. I can say that I have witnessed cases where the power of faith has gone beyond what medicine can do, but I have never seen a rational justification for ignoring good medical treatment. The lie in that claim can be found in the practice of Jesus himself. In the text we heard today, Jesus uses the medical technology of his day. Spittle has healing properties. Just watch an animal lick its wounds to know that that's true. And the use of plasters is ancient medicine and is still used today to reduce boils and draw infection out of deep wounds. Jesus was a practical healer in addition to being a deep spiritual healer. So our scripture points us to the wisdom of following practical medical and epidemiological advice as we face the COVID-19. It also shows us that Jesus was opposed to the blame game, especially blaming the victim. This should not surprise us, since Jesus himself was the supreme victim of human hatred and evil and indifference. What is more, we see the spin doctors of the first century at work in this text. They were spreading false rumors, explanations, and attacking those who spoke the truth and practiced mercy. So too today with the spin doctors. They not only spin COVID-19, they spin every aspect of our common life in order to divide us and make us jealous and greedy and selfish and mean-spirited toward one another. We can see this in empty aisles in the pharmacies and groceries across the country. Although there is plenty to go around, the spin doctors are driving us to hoard so that we, the few, get too much and the many get too little. This is how the few manipulate the vilest instincts in us all, so that we lash out at others and form narrow circles of the us and our people and demonize others. But we must resist this, just as the blind man did when he was asked to condemn Jesus. We must not act like his parents, who did in hiding before the accusing people. But we should stand firm in embracing the gifts of compassion and love and mutuality and generosity, helping all. We can do this. Jesus refers to these choices as works of the day and works of the night. Works of the night are those that spread division and selfishness, fear and hatred, pitting one against another and flaming the passions of negativity that divide. The Hebrew word for evil stems from the Hebrew word for division or divided. When humans divide and separate from God, evil comes forth. When we ourselves are inwardly divided, evil comes forth. When we divide ourselves from others and our community and our world, evil comes forth. It is this evil that is manipulating, that the manipulating people use to build their empires of tyranny and greed. Consider that all God created was indeed very good. Evil then must be a misdirection of what was good in the original design. A hammer is a useful tool for building things, but it can become a murder weapon. A rock can be used to build a house or thrown at someone else. Water can keep us alive or drown someone. Our words are the same. Whether you're a Democrat, a Republican, an independent, or a progressive, you can use words for the greater good or for evil. Let's practice care with this. Now, I must confess to you that I'm oft tempted to repost or like a kind of nasty little mime on the internet, which criticizes the people that I don't like as much. I really shouldn't be doing that. So let's try together to avoid it. This text also offers us an interesting element, and it talks about sight and vision. The man healed was blind, but came to see. While the nasty religious authorities had no trouble with their physical eyes, but could not see the compassionate love of God. Of course, we like to think of ourselves like the blind man who came to see, but in reality, often we're more like those religious leaders who refuse to see love and compassion. We fall into suspicions and innuendos and suggestions of impropriety, seeming illogic, all the rest, rather than look for the compassionate way. How often have our views so frozen that we cannot hear someone speak truth that we have not wanted to hear? How often have we dismissed those who ask us to practice radical generosity and love and looked at them as fools? How often have we allowed fear to keep us from taking the risk of hospitality and generosity? These are not uncommon events for us, since we use a lot of shorthand in our thinking to keep ourselves from having to meet each day with fresh eyes and open minds. We're actually pretty lazy thinkers. Jesus bids us, though, open our hearts so that the eyes of our hearts might lead us into the fresh experience of the day. An experience where we meet God again and again, especially in the most unlikely of people. This, my friends, is how the healing light works in us and spreads in the world. If we truly want to share the gospel with others, then we must let the healing light of Christ work in our own eyes so that we see God's truth and light, and then, in the love that fills us, share it with others. Amen.
Thank you.
And now, friends, I'd like to share some prayers with you at this time, as we are going through many challenges. Oh, dear Lord, we feel anxiety, fear, just general worry. Some of us are angry at those who have made matters worse or have not fixed them fast enough. Oh, Lord, open our hearts to your generous love. Help us to trust in you in the midst of this time of struggle and challenge. Oh God, you divided the waters of chaos at creation. In Christ, you stilled the storms and raised the dead and vanquished demonic powers. Oh Lord, tame the earthquake, wind, and fire and all the forces that defy control and shock us with their fury. Keep us from calling disaster your justice. Help us in good times and in distress to trust in your mercy and yield to your power. Oh God, in whose appointment our life stands and who committed our work to us, we commit our cares to you. We thank you that we are your children and that you have assured us that while we are intent upon your will, you will heed our wants. Fill us with that compassion for others' troubles, which comes from the forgetfulness of our own, with the clarity of those who know their own unworthiness, and with the glad hope of the children of eternity. Let us remember Jesus, who was mighty indeed, healing the sick and the disordered, using for others the power he would not invoke for himself, who refused to force people's allegiance, who was master and Lord of his disciples, yet was among them as their companion and as one who served, whose desire was to do the will of God, the one who sent him. Oh, let us remember Jesus, who believed in people and never despaired of them, who through all disappointment never lost heart, who disregarded his own comfort and convenience and thought first of others' needs, and though he suffered long, was always kind, who, when he was reviled, uttered no harsh word in return, and when he suffered, did not threaten retaliation, who humbled himself and carried obedience to the point of death. Teach us, O God, and teach every nation to see every question of national policy in light of our faith, that we may check in ourselves and in others every passion that makes for war, for ungenerous judgment, all promptings of self-assurance and presumptuousness in our claims. Grant us insight to recognize the needs and aspirations of other nations and remove our suspicions and misunderstandings, that we may honor all people in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Look graciously, O Lord, upon this land, where it is in pride, subdue it, where it is in need, supply it, where it is in error, rectify it, where it is in default, restore it, and where it holds to that which is just and compassionate, support it. O God of all ages, in your sight nations rise and fall and pass through times of peril. Now when our land is troubled, be near to judge and to save. May leaders be led by your wisdom. May they search your will and see it clearly. If we have turned from your way, reverse our ways and help us to repent. Give us your light and your truth. Let them guide us through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of the world. And Lord, you are almighty and merciful. Of your bountiful goodness, keep us from all things that may hurt us, that we, being ready in both body and soul, may cheerfully accomplish those things which you have commanded. Through Jesus Christ, who gives us strength when we are weak, rest when we are tired, grace from trials, the ability to help others, your unfailing sympathy, and the capacity to share that with others. And most importantly, your undying love in Christ Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Dear friends, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Allow Christ Jesus' Spirit enter into you to bring healing in your body, in your relationships, and in our world. May you trust in the love of God in all things and share the mercy and grace of God with all whom you meet. Amen.